Hello everybody, good evening on this Sunday evening, the 26th of February. We are driving a DGTL 2-hour endurance race this evening in GTR2. This time around we've come to Sepang in Malaysia, and qualifying's begun. It's been going for around 15 minutes, and let's just have a look at the action. Hello. My name is Lesser, and I'm going to commentate alone again, but I hope you can endure me. Also, hopefully this time around that we will have sound on the live stream, or at least the recording of the live stream. The ones of you watching it last time live, you did have sound, and the ones of you who didn't, you didn't have any sound at all. So, yeah. Hopefully all that fixed. As I was saying, qualifying session has begun. A bit unusual for where we are, perhaps. It is raining quite a bit, actually. It's a wet qualifying session. And as you can see, we're watching Nikolaj Pedersen in his Aston Martin DBR 1/2 at the moment, and he's kicking up quite a bit of water spray, actually. Oh, and the wet weather catching Nikolaj Pedersen out. Nikolaj Pedersen, this time around, again, he's managed to be quicker in qualification, so far at least, than our all-time star, so to say, Henrik Højer. Henrik Højer is, of course, also with us in his Epsilon SKD. He's in the pits right now. He's only 0.04 of a second slower than Nikolaj Pedersen. But we have seen Nikolaj being able to actually outperform Henrik Højer, which is quite a difference from the beginning of the season. Unfortunately, that's for now all the LMP1 cars we have. I know we have some LMP1 drivers with technical difficulties. We have one driver who fried his main board in his computer, so he won't be competing. I remember it as that being Henning Pedersen, so he's not going to come tonight. Kasparov is of course with us. He's in first position in GT1 at the moment, actually a second in front of Peter Munkholm. Kasparov running his usual red and white Lamborghini Murciélago RGT. Also on the field is Peter Munkholm. He is driving his Corvette C6R today instead of the Chrysler Viper. If you were wondering, yes, Peter does lose all of his points. Every single point he's earned up till now in the 12-hour race, the 24-hour race, all of it, it's gone because he's changed his car out for the Chrysler Viper. But as as all of us were pretty much aware, and himself also, the Chrysler Viper was not fast enough to compete, and he had already been taken with the results of the race from Suzuka. He had been overtaken in the championship standings, and that unfortunately means that in the Viper he couldn't win. Of course, it just wasn't quick enough. So he's decided to have a bit of fun instead, so he's driving in a car he really likes, and that's the Corvette. And it really does sound good, that thing. Mostly in real life, but also in-game. The next guy in the server is, of course, Chris Daunce. Chris Daunce with us again. He was so close to winning last time at Suzuka. But, of course, we're expecting him to see... we're expecting to see him go for it again this time around. He's not quite as quick as the two front runners at the moment, but that might depend on who's gotten up before the track's gotten really wet, and which ones of the drivers who haven't been able to set a time before the track was really beginning to get wet. If we move further down the lines, We of course have Jan Malbec with us again in the Saleen S7R. The Saleen usually able to compete on lap times, so let's just see what he can pull out of his sleeve. Gert Nielsen in the Aston Martin DBR9 is here as well. Gert Nielsen, not much to I haven't got much to say about this guy actually, but he's really done. He did quite well at the Suzuka last time around. We saw him have some nice fights, even though it was in a bit of the latter part of the field. He really did have some nice fight with some of the other GT1 cars. So I'm hoping to see some clean racing from him again. Of course, Ben Jewell is with us again here. As I remember it, he wasn't competing at Suzuka, but he has been at the previous few races, and he's here again. And Ben Jewell in the number 3 Team Colling Racing Aston Martin. As I've mentioned in the earlier races, they of course competed at the 24 Hours of Le Mans back in October. And by far was actually the quickest car there of the Team Colling Racing team. So the number 3 car is really quick. Number 3 car consists of Ben Jewell, who we have driving here with us this evening, but also the rest of the guys in the car is Mark Jewell, which is actually Ben Jewell's son, and he's become really, really quite fast. He's a bugger to keep up with sometimes. And they have another guy in their car as well. It's not quite as fast as the two others, but he seems to be quite stable. I think his name is Lasse Sørensen, but it says so in yeah. You can see that in the windshield there. His name is Lasse Sørensen. That's the last driver. But Ben Jewell driving the Team Colling Racing 3 car this evening at Sepang, and I suspect he's able to compete somewhere in the from the middle and up in the field today. So not so many cars yet, but there is still half an hour of qualification remaining, and people of course still have time to join in on the server. And as expected, we saw a few more guys join in there. That was Steen Steinecke. You might remember this car, it's the green and white Lamborghini Murcielago RGT. Steen Steinecke has really gotten some nice fights in with the Lambos high up in the field. Ben Jewell proving to be a bit slow in the rain actually. It's running 2:10.2, but it's not too woeful. He might just catch up. It's his first counting lap. The back end just kicking out on the Aston Martin here, and just barely touches on the grass here, and he has to reverse it out again. That stuff happens when it rains, and of course we aren't professionals, and the drivers make a few mistakes. Tristan's in the one of the red and white Lamborghinis is taking first position in GT1. He's just overtaking his teammate Kasper Augaard, and he's done so with 0.06 of a second. So these two guys are really competing closely again, it would seem, and it would really be nice to see them have as close racing as they had 2 weeks ago on Suzuka. Here we see Stenis Stenica. He's going down the back straight. And he's being followed by the Aston Martin of Benju. He overtakes him there because he makes a little mistake. And the Aston Martin LMP of Nikolai Pedersen, he's overtaking them on the outside there. As you can clearly tell, there's quite a bit of spray being kicked out right now, so if the weather is better on the weather is better for the race on the race day, I was going to say, but technically in the game it's a different day, but of course it's just in half an hour here. So if the weather is nicer on race day, of course we're also expected to see faster lap times. Oh, Benju just picking up a bit of sand there. Kicks up a little bit of dust. The green timing you can see in the top left corner there, that's Henrik Højer. That means he's improved on his one of his sector times, and he's in front of his best lap time at the moment, so he's probably going to improve on that in just a few minutes. A few seconds, rather. There we are. There he is. Oh, really hitting the curb hard there. Back end steps out a bit. Nothing that's going to destroy the lap time, but he's on minus 1.1 second now on the sector 2 split time. He's going up the backside of the grandstands now. Then comes the hairpin, and then he's going down the start and finish straight. We'll just watch a few laps here and watch how the lap times progress. And then I'll give you a short tour of the Sepang circuit here in Malaysia. Yeah, Henrik Højer improving quite radically on his lap time. Now he's down in 1:54.9 now, so he's actually over 1.5 seconds in ahead of Nikolai Pedersen in the Aston Martin DBR12. That might be a sign of the circuit drying up a bit, but I doubt that's the case because it is still raining quite a bit, as you can perhaps tell. Here comes the Aston Martin. I think he's out to improve his lap time as well. Going around the final corner, he's coming out to the start and finish straight. 1:54.9 to beat. 1:54.3, he does it! If you're wondering what that was, I am still on the TeamSpeak channel. If you're wondering what that was, as I was saying, if you're wondering what that was, I'm still on the TeamSpeak channel with the drivers, so you can hear all the radio communications the drivers in between here. And that was just actually Nikolai Pedersen and Henrik Højer just discussing the lap times they just did. They both say that the conditions are pretty difficult. It's getting wetter and wetter, as I suspected. He also said that Henrik Højer spends a lot more time in the first sector compared to what Nikolai Pedersen does, but Nikolai Pedersen actually said that he's not running his engine full tilt, So he's notched it down a bit to make the car more controllable, whereas Henrik Højer, he's going full speed. Oh, Nicola Pedersen improving the time yet again. He's now down in 1:54.19, so 0.2. So he's actually above more than 0.07 of a second, 0.7 of a second. It's the drivers. Here's the drivers discussing whether or not it's going to rain in the race. Nicolai Wilson doesn't sound too happy about the perspective of it raining in the race. Henrik Højer was actually on a better lap time there, but he unfortunately fucked it up on the curb there. There's Peter proclaiming that he's the weather god of GTR2, or rather that he lives inside GTR2, so he knows what the weather is going to be.
Oh boy, slow down.
Okay. While I've been jabbing here.
Nu er det gået, der er
just realized you aren't actually able to hear the drivers. You are now.
Nå, jeg er tilbage om 20 minutter, jeg skal lige sove lidt.
Det tror jeg fandme ikke får at sige til Peter.
Wow.
Det var fandme en kort lur, hva' Peter?
Det var sandt en kort lur.
Ej, I lyder som om jeg snart skal til at sætte kvalset op.
Du kan godt lige styre brænderen med, ikke? Alt under 2.6, det er ulovligt.
Jamen, så lad være med at lægge på regnlæs, dæk.
Der er skam heller ikke.
Okay, så det får man ikke til at lide. Det kan jeg allerede røbe nu.
Ja.
A little bit of setup here. Now you are actually able to hear what the drivers are saying. They're discussing the weather at the moment.
Så meget vil jeg godt afsløre.
Peter says he says he's on dry tires actually, and the wet tires aren't working. The tracks isn't wet enough for that.
Det ser ud af mere end der.
Ja, det er ikke bad.
Oh, sorry, Henrik, jeg havde ikke lige set det komme.
Det gør ikke noget, bare blokke hans hurtige omgange.
Ej, jeg tror, i stedet for så bliver det mega awesome slipstream, men jeg er ikke helt sikker.
Both Nicolai Pedersen and Henrik Højer are actually improving on their laps again. You can see the lap times are green, that means they have better sector times than the ones they already have. And Henrik Højer is going for the final corner now. We still have 23 minutes of qualification remaining, so there's plenty of time to set a quicker lap time. Henrik Højer takes back full position here. You can hear him moaning a bit in the background. 1:52.75 clean.
Jeg smider lige 0.6 væk.
So He's in front again now. Nikolaj Pedersen said he just threw out a lap with minus 0.6 in one sector. And his the tail of his car looks quite squiggly.
52.
So we might not have more than two LMP1 cars here, but they are certainly battling it out. They are providing some nice entertainment, even though they only are two guys. What Henrik Høyer just said there was that this time is actually only 4 seconds slower than his quickest lap time in the dry, so it isn't all that too wet, it seems. PJ Monk on that again. While I were japping about the LMP1 cars, in GT1, PJ Monk was overtaking the first position in the Corvette, so it's a completely different story now, it seems, as PJ Monk and the Corvette are actually able to keep up on pace as well. But the Corvette, don't underestimate its economy, it is actually quite an economical car. So I don't think he will have any problems with if let me say it this way, if the Lamborghini is able to single stop a race, he definitely will. Du har
godt, det ikke virker det der SimRace TV sidste gang med lyden.
Ja, det er der styr på.
Okay.
Og mystisk er det ikke, hvad hedder det med stream, men ikke på
This is kind of an interactive experience. Right now we're discussing why the sound wasn't working last time. The reason for what didn't work last time, if you really want the technicalities, is because the program we use to send these things, which is called XSplit, and we have different options for how to encode the sound. And the sound was in the wrong codec, so it could send the sound out at the live stream, but for some reason it can't record the sound in the saved files in that codec. So we didn't know until the race was over, because it worked on the live stream, but the recordings didn't work.
Må jeg så godt gå ud og
sove
nu, Kasper?
Peter Monk
om... Det gør Peter ikke det pisse mere.
Ingen besejrer den hellige bule, for hendes hellige pole position omgangstid.
2-0-0-3, sådan ikke noget pisse her. Sådan.
That's the reaction you get from driving 2 seconds
det
quicker.
Det skulle være
løgn, åbenbart. That's Peter Monk om just driving...
skal lige under 2 minutter, så.
2 minutes, 2 minutes point 3, clean. So I love discussions here on the channel.
Nina, skal du ikke køre en anden bil? Den der Corvette plejer du ikke at køre i den?
Nej!
Det må være ulovligt. Ud!
Nej, det er fuldt ulovligt. Jeg skal bare lige
bringe væk. Ja.
Du havde alligevel tabt.
Kasper går being cocky here, saying he already had lost. That's why he changed his
car. Jeg synes, det er synd, fordi du bare stod, at du kunne vinde på Spa. Ja. Viberen.
Ja, det kan også problemet.
Ja, jeg synes, det var noget sjovere at køre den her, så der var noget mere konkurrence her foran, i stedet for at jeg bare ligger dernede og kører 5. og 6. pladser hjem.
Anyway.
Ja, den der bil kan altså godt vinde på Spa.
Så kan du få lov til at køre 3. og 4. pladser ind nu, eller hvad?
I think, there we go. I think I'll just shut up these drivers here. What they're talking about here was the thing I was talking about earlier, that Peter Monkholm changed his car. Because he'd already lost the championship in the Chrysler Viper, and Kasper Hågaard being a bit cocky there, but we're getting used to that by now. Anyway, what I was going to say is, with 18 minutes remaining of qualifying, I suggest we take a small tour of the circuit, or an introduction to the Sepang circuit. The circuit is actually called officially the Sepang International Circuit, or abbreviated SIC. It is in Sepang, the city of Sepang, in a region called Selangor in Malaysia, and it is quite near to the airport, the Kuala Lumpur airport actually. and not far away from the capital of Malaysia, which is Kuala Lumpur, of course, also. Sepang, you might know Sepang from hosting the Malaysian Formula 1 Grand Prix, of course, but he also hosts the A1 Grand Prix and the Malaysian Motorcycle Grand Prix, and it's been used for a series of major motorsports events. The circuit was opened in March 1999, so it's only 13 years old in a few days. And the construction of the circuit began in 1997, in November of 1997, and it is what is called a Grade A or Grade 1 FIA circuit, so it's licensed to drive the quickest of races, which is of course why the Formula 1 cars drive there. The circuit is designed or drawn, or what you'd like to call it, by a German called Hermann Tilke, and Hermann Tilke, besides the Sepang circuit, he's also done circuits like Shanghai, Bahrain, the Istanbul Park circuit, Valencia, Singapore, and also circuits in Korea and India. So if you think the type and the layout of the circuit seems similar to others, what we call stadium circuits like Valencia and Istanbul, of course Bahrain and Shanghai also, as I mentioned, it's because they're designed by the same guy actually. So of course the circuits seem a bit alike. It's 5.54 kilometers long, and the lap record is set by Juan Pablo Montoya in 2004 in the Williams BMW Racer, and it is a time of 1:34.2. Let's just go on board with Kasper Hougaard here to see the circuit. The circuit has 15 corners. Coming up here is this corner number one. Oh, Kasper Hougaard going a bit wide. Oh, of course, a tradition when I want to go on board with somebody, they pit in. Buggers. Let's just find another car here, going for a new lap. That's not a new lap, don't want you. It's been you, he's going for a new lap. It's not. It's Gert Nielsen, that's corner number one. This is corner number two, then you head out on the throttle slowly, but still as quickly as you can out of this tricky exit of this corner. That's corner number three, this long right there. It's flat out all the way. It changes to sector 2 here, and then comes corner number 4. Corner number 4 actually a lot slower than you'd think it is, and it's very tricky. If you exit it too hard, the car will just spin up at the hill there. It unsettles the car. That's corner number 4, and here comes corner number 5. Now he's in corner number 6, this right-hander here. Short straight bit, then he comes up to corner number 7. Corner number 7 and 8. Combination here is actually very tricky to get right and can be taken very quickly. It's frightening just jumping off the curbs there quite a bit. Here he's coming up to corner number 9. Just after this corner is done, he changes into sector number 3. And this right hand corner is corner number 10. They don't have any names here, the corners. This is corner number 11. Then on the throttle again, and corner number 12 and 13. In the dry, probably flat out, but not quite in this weather. Then comes corner number 14, and now you're actually going up the back side of the start and finish straight, so to speak. So the grandstands in there on the left side, they are double faced, so there are spectators looking the other way as well. Because in a moment here, we come out to corner number 15. It's a 180 degree hairpin almost to the left. That we are going down along the same row of grandstands again. You can see the grandstands here are, as I said, double faced. And there's the start and finish line. So that's actually the lap of Sepang. Besides, of course, this circuit at the Sepang Motorsports Arena. or the international circuit, as it's called. You also have karting facilities and facilities for motocross racing. In the meantime here, Henrik Højer improving further on his time. He's in 1 minute and 51 seconds something now. And he's actually having more minus, so I think the circuit is drying up. I think the circuit is drying up because the cars are actually going quicker and quicker. The lap time Peter Munkholm just set, where everybody was screaming out loud, of 2 minutes dead, 2 minutes 0.2, I think it was. That's been beaten several times already. First by Kasper Hougaard, who went a tiny bit quicker, then by Chris Stuntz, he's done 59.8, and now Peter Munkholm has just taken it back again with a 59.4. So definitely the circuit's drying up, all the drivers are getting much quicker for some unapparent reason. Here comes the corner number 7 and 8 combination, really very abrupt corners, so to speak, very sharp angles. Not a soft flowing corner, but that's also why you have to make these two corners into a single one and then hit the two apexes just perfectly, just touching the curve really slightly to get quick through there. Now he's heading for corner number 12 and 13. As I said, these might be flat out for the GT cars if the conditions were better. And corner number 14, the grandstand's coming up in the view. There they are. Going around the backside of the grandstands, under the Malaysia banner. Then corner number 15, breaking hard for the hairpin. Turn it in, get on it as soon as possible again. Heading back down the other side of the grandstands and passing the finish line. The pit entrance is in combination with the corner number 15. Just on the outside of the hairpin, just before the start and finish straight. It took me quite quite a few times to actually find the pit entrance on this circuit. It might be a bit tricky getting in there. But really nice facilities actually at Sepang. Of course it's a very new track, as I said, it's only just a bit over 10 years old. So it doesn't have the charm or the history of older circuits like Monza or the Nürburgring. But it's a very safe and very modern location, very nice little facilities, and of course it's a part of the rapidly growing eastern part of the world. Anyway, we have 9 minutes remaining for qualification now. The cars are still improving their time. Henrik Højer is now down in 1 minute 51.1. So he's rapidly approaching his quickest lap times. Nikolaj Pill is not far behind. He's in 51.7 now. And he's still going for it. Whereas Henrik Højer, he's actually taking a short session in the pits right now. Chris Dons is the first guy to come under 58.5. They're really approaching dry lap times now. Peter Munkholm is the first of the top three GT1 cars to hit the circuit again. Kasper Hougaard is also having another go. I think, as I said earlier, the circuit must be drying up because they're going quicker and quicker. And that makes for a really interesting qualification session. Just below 8 minutes remaining. So, with an outlap and two or three two or three tries more. That's what they can make by now. That's all there's time for. So it's really it's the last frontier they're having here, the drivers. That's the last chance to improve their lap times. And I think Peter McCall might be going for this one. He should be able to keep up with the Lambos. That's not a line he want to take in on the qualification lap. I think actually the game might punish him for that and make the lap not count. Okay, here's the hairpin, and he's on the start and finish straight now. Here comes his first try to improve his lap time further. Crosses the line, the time starts. Not as much spray as we've seen earlier, so it seems to be correct that the circuit is drying. Into corner number one, corner number two didn't go quite as wide as some of the cars we've seen earlier. Carefully on the throttle, he makes that nicely. The long number three corner into the next sector. Here comes corner number four. The tricky, sharp right-hander. Then corner number five, long left. Into corner number six, long right. This is like racing, medium right. Or rallying, rather, sorry. Here comes the tricky 7-8 combination I've been talking about. He looked to just kiss the curbs there, so that's neat. Sector time here to beat this 1:15.2, but that's an LMP1 time, so you can't really have that as a reference. It's plus 4.9 there, but that's behind an LMP1 car. It's behind Nikolai Pedersen's time. Nikolai Pedersen is actually down on 1:50 now, so he's in front in the LMP1 again. The LMP1 car swapping yet again. Here he comes. He's going down the backside of the grandstands, going for the final corner. I'm not sure this one will be quick enough to beat Christons and Kasper Ogor, but let's just have a look what he's able to pull out. He has 6 seconds to reach the line. 2 seconds. Does it? He takes Kasper Ogor, but he doesn't make it all the way up to Christian Johansen. But now, so Peter Munkholm is second position in GT1 now. Christian still on the circuit as well as Kasper Ogor. Kasper Ogor just sets the best time now. He topped that by over a second. He's down in 1.57. Oh, well, sorry, 1:57 dead now. He just went over a second quicker than the other GT1 cars. That's impressive. Chris Dunn's his last lap there didn't bring anything with it. He's still on 1:58.26. Peter Munkholm 1:58.32. He needs to have another go if he wants to. At least have the second position. I think it's a long way down to first position in GT1 now. Almost 1.5 seconds. Jan Mulbaker's also under 2 minutes now, so that's acceptable. Benjul, Gert Nielsen, Steen Stenicke, they're a bit slower. It's still quite close, actually. They're all within a second, these three guys, so probably going to see some close racing from them as well. Yet again, Nikolai Pedersen, the green lap time up there, indicating he's improving his time again. He's really going for it. Here comes Peter, he's trying to retrake at least second position in qualification. Question is, there's 2 minutes and 45 seconds remaining of the qualification session. And the question is whether or not he will actually be able to make it to the start and finish line and get all the way around and set the time before the timer runs out. You are given a bit of slack, around approximately 30 seconds or so, more than the session time. The game gives you that to complete the lap you're on, but that's it. He has 2 minutes and 8 seconds here, so he'll make it. That's plenty of time for him to set a lap time, but it's going to be his first counting lap time this try. So, the car might not be warmed up yet. That's an awful long way down to 157 dead. Let's just have a look at this. A bit more aggressive through the turn 1 and 2 combination. And notice there's really not much spray remaining now. The rain spray has practically disappeared. It's kicking up a bit more rain now, a bit more water at the circuit there. That's because it got away from the racing line a bit. The racing line is actually really dry now, so it's really it's a balancing act. Going quickly but still staying in the black line because the racing line has dried out now. See? There. You can see it, you can tell there. As soon as he leaves the racing line, it begins to kick up water again. That's corner number 14. He's going for the Malaysia banner. Corner number 15 coming up. It's the final corner. 1 minute 45. It's 12 seconds to reach the start and finish line. 7 seconds, 6 seconds. 55, 56, 57. Oh, he tops Chris Dons by around half a second, so that's good enough for science if you've ever played Portal 2. 1 minute 57.8 dead, and the qualification session timer is actually over now. So now the drivers get the extra 30 seconds I were talking about earlier. Gert Nielsen, he gets to set another time. 2 minutes 0.7 is his best time. The only guy left on the circuit is Kasper Holgaard. Where is he? Oh, he's not even on the back straight yet. I'm not sure he's gonna make it. That's the back straight. We're going for the Malaysia banner in just a moment. There we are. And that's the next session sign. He doesn't make it. He doesn't make it. So those are the standings for the qualification. Nikola Pedersen in front and Henrik Koya just behind. And then comes all the GT1 cars. Kasper Holgaard, Chris Dons, Johansson, and then Peter Munkholm. So Chris Dons actually seems to have gotten in a quicker lap time just on the final leg there. It's 1 minute and 33 seconds remaining now for the cars to get on the grid, and we will just have a short break here to divide the stream up into two recorded bits, and I will be back in a few seconds.